Okay, well, in this lesson, what we're going to do next is we're going to look at the antiderivative, looking at the integral in terms of the antiderivative. Okay, so let's go ahead and switch some colors around here. Oh, good, it's black. That's what I want. Okay, so what we need to do next is we need to look at the integral as an antiderivative, or in other words, as a reverse derivative. Antiderivative. Okay, so what we're saying here is that if I have some function, capital F of x, and if I take the derivative with respect to x of that function, I get capital F prime of x, and that's equal to lowercase f of x. So let me give an example. Let's say that little f of x is equal to x cubed. What I'm saying is that this function here, x cubed, is the derivative of some capital F of x. So in other words, capital F prime of x is x to the third power. And my goal as the math student is to find the function that differentiates to give me x cubed. Well, using the antiderivative on polynomials is rather easy. This is going to be 1/4 x to the fourth power plus some constant is equal to the antiderivative of that function. Now let me just show you that that's true. Let's differentiate this. So if I take the derivative with respect to x of 1/4 x to the fourth plus any unknown constant, this could be any real number in the universe, well, I differentiate by normal. I power down, so this becomes 4/4 x to the third, and the derivative of a constant is 0, so I'm just left with x cubed. So this is the legitimate antiderivative of x cubed, and we're going to call this capital F of x. So capital F of x is the antiderivative of x cubed. Now how do I show an antiderivative mathematically? Well, first of all, how did we show a derivative mathematically? What we've been doing in the first 6 chapters is we've been doing this. D dx of f of x is equal to f prime of x. That's how you show that you're taking the derivative of something. So how do you show you're taking the antiderivative of something? Well, what you do is you use the integral symbol. And this is equal to capital F of x. Now, this guy right here is called the indefinite integral. Okay. It's indefinite because when we integrate it, we'll integrate it up to a constant. In other words, it'll be some function plus c. So it won't be a definite, specific, exact function. It will be a function, but it will be up to a constant, where the constant can be anything in the universe, any real number in the universe it can be. Okay? Now, in the last lesson, we figured out how to find the area using the antiderivative. Here's an example. If we go from 0 to 1 of x squared dx, remember the integral symbol means find the antiderivative of. But because I have a lower and an upper limit here, these no longer make an indefinite integral. This makes what's called a definite integral. This is a definite integral. This would give me the area under the parabola from 0 to 1. That's what that would do. And this is going to give me a real number, by the way. That's what that's going to give me. It's going to give me a real number. Well, if I anti-differentiate this, I get 1/3 x cubed plus c. But what I do next is I use the endpoints of the intervals, 0 and 1. So first we plug in 1, and I have 1/3 1 cubed plus c minus 1/3 0 cubed plus c. That's how you evaluate a definite integral. You take the upper value, plug it into your expression, minus the lower value plugged into your expression. And notice what's going to happen here. It's just going to give me 1/3. The constant actually cancels out. So when you're doing a definite integral, you don't need the constant because it will always cancel out. So this is the exact area, by the way, under the curve, the parabola, x squared, from 0 to 1. 1/3 is the exact area. But can you take the integral or the antiderivative and get another function? Yes. Now remember, this right here is a real number, okay? It's not a function. We want to get a function. So what we'll do instead is we'll integrate from 0 to x, to some variable. Now, the moment you do this, you can't let the variable here... x squared is good enough. You can't let the variable here match the variable here because that would cause a series of problems. You've got to understand that the variable here is called a dummy variable, okay? So instead of x cubed, we're going to choose what's called a dummy variable. Let's go ahead and erase that. And my eraser needs to be a little bit bigger here. Better. Okay. All right, so I'm going to choose the letter T. Okay. So now I integrate with respect to T. This is just a dummy variable. So I find the antiderivative of this, which is 1/3 T cubed. Now technically it would be plus C, but remember that'll always cancel out. So when I find a definite, I don't use the plus C. Now I evaluate from 0 to x. Now I plug this in. And I get 1/3 x cubed minus 1/3 0 cubed, but that's just 0, so I get 1/3 x cubed, and that right there is my capital F of x. So this is a real function now, not just a real number, but a real function of x. And that's how you can use the definite integral to get not just a number, which is the area under the curve, but an actual function of x. You can get that using the definite. All right, let's look at the following right here. Here's the integral from 1 to 2 of e to the 3x dx. Now, first of all, will this give you a real number or will this give you a function? This will give you a real number, because the lower and the upper values here are real numbers themselves. So this will give you the area under the curve on the interval from 1 to 2 of the function e to the 3x, which looks something like this. And that will give you the area under the curve right in here. So this will give you some kind of a real number. Now, what is the antiderivative of e to the 3x? Well, hey, it's 1/3 e to the 3x. Now, if this was indefinite, I would say plus c. But this is not indefinite. This is definite. So I could go ahead and say plus c, but the moment I evaluate it, the c's will cancel out. So why bother? So what we do here is we just say from 1 to 2. This little guy right here is called, you know, this is the evaluation bar. And the way that you do it is you plug 2 in first. So 1/3 e to the 6 minus 1/3 e to the 3. And this right here represents the exact area under the curve of e to the 3x from 1 to 2. That's the exact value. Okay. Integrating this, this is a definite integral. And so what will this give you, a real number or a function? This will give you a function, and it will be a function of y. So we'll say that this is capital F of y. So now I find the antiderivative of each part. This is 1/5 y to the fifth plus 2/3 y. Oops. I'm jumping ahead of myself. Shame on me. Shame on me. Ah, jumping ahead of myself. It's so easy to do that. What am I doing wrong? I'm glad I did it, because if you could see me make mistakes, then I can correct them. What did I do wrong? I started plugging in y's, and I'm not ready to do that yet. This needs to be the variable of integration, t. So there we go, 2/3 t cubed. There we go. Evaluated from 0 to y. Now we plug in y, and I get 1/5 y to the fifth plus 2/3 y to the third, okay, minus 1/5 0 to the fifth plus 2/3 0 to the third. Now, it won't always turn out that this guy at the end turns out to be 0. It just does in this case. So I'm left with 1/5 y to the fifth power plus 2/3 y to the third power. And that right there is my function of y integrated from 0 to some unknown value y. That's my function of y. Again, this guy is called a definite integral. This is also a definite integral. So you've got to know which definite integrals give you real numbers and which definite integrals give you functions. Okay? All right, that's this part of the lesson finished. God bless you wherever you are today.